it's good to see some familiar faces in the audience and to be a part of this. I hope that it'll be a discussion, a conversation with you. My name is Simon Woolley. I'm the director of Operation Blackboat. And when I saw the title of this lecture, if you like, in the name of Paul Stephenson, I don't know whether you know about Paul, but if you don't, you should. Because this man was part of something that has not been acknowledged here in the UK. How many in the audience are from the USA? I know you are. That's why I asked the question. Look, all of us know about the civil rights movement, right? Dr. Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, Angela Davis, the heroes and sheroes that we've watched on our TVs, that we have revered in their fight for social and racial justice. But what saddens me as an activist fighting for social and racial justice is that our heroes and sheroes are not effectively highlighted. And when you look at the history of Paul Stephenson, back in the 60s, took on a monster of racism that was the Bristol Bus Company. And the unions in the Bristol Bus Company said that if you're black, you can't work on the buses. And so you know what he did as a young man? He did what Rosa Parks did and Martin Luther King did. He organized a bus boycott. A bus boycott. There was lots of black people in Bristol at the time. He said, we're not stepping on the buses until you change your policy that bans black people from working on the bus. A bus boycott back in the 1960s that paralleled the Rosa Parks bus boycott. And in that struggle, and in that fight, actually, he forced the British government, the monster that is Westminster, to recognize the racial inequality that was prevalent in the UK, characterized, like all of you know, no blacks, no Irish, no dogs. That you couldn't even work for public transport if you were the same you as me here today. He fought that battle, and as a result, it precipitated the 1964 Race Relations Act. He did that. Here's what I'm saying today, 2017. We have to write it. We have to do it. Here in the UK, from Paul Stephenson to Doreen Lawrence to the Notting Hill Carnival to the black farmer, Wilfred Emanuel, you're hearing later, to Operation Black Vote. We've had our own black British civil rights movement that has transformed our institutions. The tragedy is we haven't named it. There's these disparate individuals, but if you sew a golden thread between all these activities, the deaths, the trauma, the marches, the marches on Westminster, accumulative, it's been a civil rights movement that has made us the global epicenter, if you like, of black civil rights in Europe. It was the black civil rights movement in Europe that transformed the dialogue in the European Union to have a race equality directive. Now, every country in the European Union has a race directive because of the UK. Because of UK activism. These elements are not even talked about in our schools. We need to celebrate it. We need to acknowledge it. But so, you know, we've come a long way. I think there was a high point. I think there was a high point in after the Stephen Lawrence brutal murder, and the inquiry. But the fact that Dory and black activists demanded change, that we had a Race Relations Amendment Act, that every public service in the country had to promote race equality. Every public service. Every public service had to show that it could close race equality disparities. That was the high point, I would argue. And then what happened to us? 9/11. 9/11 threw our gender asunder, because whilst we were focused on tackling the monster of institutional racism throughout the country, as you said quite rightly, in every city, in every part of the country, we had race equality councils. Funding, we had a commission for racial equality. Post 9/11, it was all about pointing the finger at us, pointing the finger at Muslims, first and foremost, and dividing our diverse communities. Hindus and Sikhs said, I'm not Muslim, don't tar me with that brush. That's true. It's true. The whole colonial mantra, divide and rule, pulled our communities apart. Yes, they did. Yes, they did. To where we are now. All of you will know, sitting here, fast forward from 9/11, that we had the most divisive referendum that this country has ever seen. Ever seen. The Brexit referendum was driven in no small measure by xenophobic bile. It was. Of course, they might say, oh, we didn't want these Europeans governing us. You know, in many ways, the Brexit debate, why you couldn't win if you was a Remainer, because the Brexit debate put this country on a war footing. It was the language of war that the Brexiteers perpetrated to poison this nation. What did they say? What was the mantra from Boris Johnson and others? We are being run by foreigners. We are being invaded by foreigners. This is war footing. If you're being run by foreigners, if you're being invaded by foreigners, that's what you say in wartime. You can't compete with that type of rhetoric. Spewed by the Daily Mail, spewed by the Sun, even poisoned some of our own communities. I was astonished, you know, to hear black people, African nations and Caribbeans, voting Brexit. Give me a break. And we learned nothing. You know, some of our communities said, oh, you know, we're too many foreigners. I beg your pardon. It's true. I beg your pardon. No, Simon, you don't understand. Look, we need to focus on the Commonwealth. You heard Nigel Farage and his wretched, poisonous lies. Let's deal with the Commonwealth. Do you think that Northern England wants more Pakistanis and Jamaicans on this country with their hatred? It was lies peddled to our communities, and it's shameful that we bought it. So of course, post-referendum, those people who had those thoughts of racism and of xenophobia, they thought it was their Christmases all come at once. They couldn't believe their luck. Now they could come out the closet and say, we make you actually, we make you too. And you know what's interesting? Is that first of all, with the Brexit debate, is that most people thought it was East Europeans and then black people. And then, for the first time in British history, did Western Europeans feel the heat too. Because in that rapid articulation, it was all foreigners. 3 days after Brexit, I was on the radio with Ian Dale, one of those LBC reporters. I sat in the studio and a woman called in. Please tell me when to stop because I get carried away. A woman called him in tears. It was an elderly German woman. 4 days after Brexit, she said on air, Michael O'Brien, the presenter was, she said, I'm sorry to tell you, but I haven't left my house for the past 4 days. And Michael O'Brien said, why? And she said, I'm afraid to leave my house. She said, I've lived in this country for 35 years with my husband. He's English. He was a doctor. We lived in this village. And 2 days ago, excrement was put through my door with a note telling me to F off back home. She said, these are the people I live with. This is my community. These are my neighbours that were saying this. And this was the devilish demons that we unleashed with this Brexit debate. So now, what do we do? Now we have to confront racism that is open. But also, as well as that, we've made so many gains in our society. We've given our children hope. And now we have to fight this, but also fight the state. Because whilst we make gains, we never really make inroads into the biggest institutions. In a way, we've been fooled. Oh yes, it's okay. Everything's equal. We're all the same. We're an open society, and we're all equal. No, we're not. No, we've never been. As a matter of fact, we sought to show this in a dramatic fashion. I was talking with a few of the people beforehand, and they all said to me. One woman said to me, look, we still can't get to the high places. We still can't be given those pathways to the top jobs. And we tested this 6 months ago. It was launched just a few months ago with The Guardian. We called it The Colour of Power. What is the colour of power? Let's have a look. And we sought to look at the public institutions, the democratic institutions, and the private institutions. What is the colour of power? Actually, women in the audience, when we have a look at this, what is the gender of power too? The intersection of gender. I've got 3 minutes. Is that 3 minutes or 30 minutes left? Let's have a look at the colour of power we did with Green Park. So we've got leaders of political parties. And at each juncture, I'm going to spot the black face. So, I'll just turn this around. These are political parties, cabinet members. Priti Patel is no longer there. Gone. Gone. Good riddance. No, I didn't say that. I just think what she did, going to Israel, a Hindu going to Israel, was just wrong. To be honest with you. Anyway. Scroll up, minister, spot the black face. Sweden at the bottom there, Sam, Mohammed, and Alam. Only three. Scottish Parliament, one in the right hand corner. Welsh Assemblies, one. Supreme Court judges, no surprise there. Armed forces, no surprise there. Agencies, zero. Permanent secretaries. These are all positions of power. These are the people that run our country. Police and crime commissioners. We know about injustice. One, Sadiq Khan. Move forward. How many police constables? Zero. It's gone. Oh my gosh. Where are you? Go back. Police commissioners, go forward. Go on, keep going. Constables, trade unions, stop. These are the trade unions that represent millions of people, most of which are from people of colour. How many black leaders of trade unions in this country? Zero. When was the last time we had a trade union leader? Anyone tell me? Bill Morris. How long ago was that? 10 years ago. Zero. Leaders of London boroughs, a few. CEOs, one. Metropolitan boroughs, Zero. Keep going. Zero. Zero. One black face. Keep going. Let's get to the business. NHS Trust, a few. Keep going. FTSE 100. Two. These are the captains and captainesses of industry. Yeah. Law firms, zero. You get the picture? Advertising agencies, consultancy firms. Look, this is a wake-up call. This is a wake-up call if you feel that this is a better place to be. That pathways to power, pathways to the top jobs for people that look like me and you, are almost non-existent. And what happens in this discourse is that you might be brilliant, but when these companies see you and the football managers, they see you as a risk, not as an asset, not as a potential. I would argue, okay, done, we're done.
Oh, wow.
We're done.
That's been warned.
We're done. Vice Chancellor, we're done. I've got the face, the nice face. And I'm finishing. You really told me if I need to go, but look. I know. Look, let's use this platform to push back. And we push back in a number of ways, which I think Loper has been brilliant in doing this. One, that we sow a golden thread in this audience with people that care. That care, that want to make a difference. You on my own can speak loud. Us together can speak louder. That we've got to nurture a young generation that's able to, one, fulfill their great ambition, but two, this caucus, this collective, has to be strong enough to say to these companies, to say to government, to say to the public servants, we're not asking for you to recognize our talent. We're demanding it. And our success, when we get to these positions, middle management, when we enter middle management, senior management, the top management, our success is everyone's success. Thank you all very much.